you guys for coming out to the first Double Midnight Comics Presents Comics. Thank you. That's good. That's Brett Parker. Everybody that doesn't know him, Chris Prue, Scott Prue, they run this great establishment. Hopefully, we're going to be doing this maybe once a month. It's every other month. Depends if you guys laugh and like it or not. Can't shake me, but if you don't like the other guys, let me know. And we can figure it out for the next time, okay?
My mother came out. I know you guys can't see her. She's over there.
She has an obsession with these little shit dogs. That like I we grew up together, like me and these fucking beasts. I just crawled around with them and they were part of me. I was part of them, this world, they raised me. And she loved them so much. She used to call them my brothers and my sisters when I was growing up. And I was like, that's fucked. Like I was still learning shit. Like, really? That's what? Okay, I see where this is going. And like in turn though, it made me fuck with other people because I'd go to school and they'd be like, oh Ryan, what's wrong? You really seem upset. Like, yeah, my brother just turned 12 and we gotta put him down. I don't want to talk about it. You go right to the principal's office with that. It's like, or I gotta tell my friends, yeah, I can't hang out today, sorry, I gotta walk my sister until she shits. That's some weird family thing we got. She has to be tethered to me. I don't know, your family's weird. Yeah, that's what I'm going with. I don't think there's anyone in there. If not, you can just barge in. We're all gonna be friends by the end of this night. I think we're gonna see each other poop. Yeah. Well, you can see me eat shit on stage, so it's okay. Right? Not physically, that's disgusting. But I did have a good childhood, speaking of eating shit. Yeah, it was fun. When I was like really young, though, I got diagnosed with ADD. And like, I was proud of it. That's when you had to try to get it. I had to prove myself. I wasn't just blinking in class a lot. Like, I had to go for it and prove it. Like, I had to go and take some tests and stuff, and that was cool. The part, though, that really bothered me is after the doctor comes in with his clipboard, because I still had clipboards then, he's like, we figured it out. You're suffering from ADD. And I just wanted to be like, no, that's not right, sir. Like, I'm not suffering from ADD. Like, everybody else around me is suffering because I have ADD. Like, this wasn't my idea to come here. I'm cool with running around the classroom.
Every class is recess if you got ADD, am I right? Thank you. You guys look like you love recess. Best class of the day, you don't even have to change. I like it. It's fun for me. So if I've had some fucked up jobs too. Oh my God, I gotta tell you something about it too. Well, I want you to hate me just a little bit because I want that to be the love hate between the host and the audience tonight. I want you guys to kind of hate me and then maybe decide later on, late tonight, be like, oh, maybe I kind of liked him. And that's what I want to do to you because that means you thought of me later tonight, which is awesome for me. It's fun. I had a really shit job though. It was I worked at Abercrombie and Fitch. You can bill me, please. That's all I have left. I have nothing else from that. Like, I'm not. What am I gonna put that on a resume? What do I want the person interviewing me to start booing me? Like, that's not gonna get me anything. So I just escorted out and said, you kind of look good, but it was horrible. Like, I had to sit there. If you haven't been to the store before, it's really just an overpriced cave. That's what they kind of. The gist of it. They just have you go into there and they spritz it around and all that stuff. It's disgusting. But I used to have to be the greeter. I have to greet people as they walked into there. Yeah, I don't know if anyone camps, but camping 101, you don't accost somebody when they first get into a cave. You like let their eyes adjust a little bit first and then you enjoy them. And I used to sit there and I pretend to fold because you don't fold in this store because if you ever just want to see a very strange type of shopping, it's kind of like if a gorilla got out. And like the shopping mall, it's like they feel the fabrics. And then once they find something they like, they just start flipping the tables looking for some discount polos. There's no discount polos. I'll tell you that from experience. So I pretend to fold. And when they'd walk in, I'd turn and be like, hey, welcome to Abercrombie & Fitch. You check out our new jeans? They'll really accentuate what you got in the front there, sir. I had to say that to strangers on a regular basis. It was absolutely ridiculous. Like, I thought I was going to have to dodge haymakers or something. But no, after one, two times, you realize you just made their fucking day. Like, that's why they came there to begin with. You get the guy like, what? I was just at Aeropostale for 2 hours and nothing made my dick pop like that. I'll pay that exorbitant amount of money you're asking for. Thank you very much. It's so expensive. Hopefully you guys are getting a little jolly out of this here thing. I put together a lineup that I didn't even think about it. It came to me in a dream. I was sleeping with all of them, and it just came together.
The first guy, though, that I'm going to bring up, very near and dear to me, he's letting us use his PA system, so he's going to sound the best through it, probably. He has that setting. But very good friend of mine. He's all over New England scene. You guys know him, Mr. Paul Landwehr. All right, hello. That's how I actually got booked. I bring the PA. All right, hello. Ryan's mom, how you doing? You didn't think I'd grow up to be so fat, did you? I used to be a soccer player, actually, right? Was I good? Who was better, me or that little fuck face over there? I'm just joking. I was better. I've been thinking about some stuff. I realized like a lot of stuff has happened to me in my life. I stayed back in third grade because of my penmanship. No one else. I stayed back in third grade for my penmanship, and I'm not over it. You know, I've been starting to think like as I'm getting older, I'm starting to put like the blame on everyone else now. Like I blame my mom. You know what I mean? I used to think I dropped out of high school because I smoked weed, but now I blame my teacher for selling it to me. You know what I mean? Like that's who the issue was. It wasn't me at all. And like in third grade, I remember my mom making me stay back because of my handwriting, and she said, "Paul, you're gonna make double the friends." I was like, the new kids have no idea who I am, and the other ones think I'm a fucking idiot. This isn't good at all. And then they were like, then they tried to convince me that, oh, it's going to help you with sports. You know, you're going to be a year ahead of everybody. But if I ever got famous, it's not like I could sign an autograph anyways. See, that kind of, good, all right, well, maybe we'll try it again. I stayed back in third grade for my, a lot of things. Like, I don't know. I think life's, I have a lot of anxiety and stuff. I have anxiety, I don't like guns, and I'm nervous to say that in New Hampshire. You can't say you don't like guns in New Hampshire. I'm not going to get political. People be like, oh, you don't like guns, Paul? Were they too deadly? I'm like, no, they're just too loud. They're just too loud for me. You know, I don't think everyone should be allowed to have a gun. Like, I have a buddy of mine. He has, like, a real family. He's got a kid. He goes hunting. He should have a gun. I shouldn't. I'm too shaky. You know what I mean? I've got the nerves about me. I get too nervous. And I don't like guns. And every time you say you don't like them, people are like, you know what, Paul? Why do you like guns? They're too deadly. I'm like, they've been known to kill somebody. And they're like, guns don't kill people. People kill people. I'm like, all right, man, I hear your point. Just put the gun down, you know? It's stressing me out. I don't like political like stuff. I always get nervous to talk about my views and everything. But I'm starting to. Like, the other day I was at the diner and I ordered bacon. And the lady said, you know, I think killing pigs is despicable. I said, you know what, you're right, I'll get some salad. She goes, well, I think plants have feelings too. I said, you know what, I guess I'll just starve myself to death and die. And she goes, actually, you don't have that right. We're legally not allowed to kill each other. I don't know if you guys knew that. I actually didn't want to be this. I actually wanted to be a mixed martial artist. I didn't want to be a comedian at all. I always wanted to be a fighter. You know what I mean? You can see it in the forearms. I used to work out a little bit. A little bit? Not at all. I wanted to be an MMA fighter, but when I was 22, I got like 3 concussions in 1 year. My neurologist said, Paul, you got to stop. And I said, okay. Because it turns out I don't like confrontation. That's the truth. I have a lot of anxiety, especially in driving and comedy. You got to drive everywhere. And my girlfriend always says to me, Paul, I know you get nervous on the highway. I know you get anxious. Just drive as safe as you can. If you need me, text me, you know? So... I always say to her, I don't think that's the safest way to drive on the highway, but then I press send. When you have anxiety disorder, it's totally different. Like if you have a bad day than if you're like a normal person. Like when you're a normal person, you have a bad day, it's like, oh man, I had a bad day, at least there's tomorrow. When you have an anxiety disorder and you have a bad day, it's like, oh shit, there's a fucking tomorrow? Oh, I'm not gonna be able to get through this one, man, not again. You know, like everything bad has happened to me in my life, everything. You know, people are always like, Paul, be positive. Just be positive. I'm like, I am positive. Something bad will always happen. I got circumcised twice as a kid. I like to watch late night TV and just like, I don't really like the reruns of Bar Rescue, but I'll watch them, you know. But it's like, you like Bar Rescue?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, John Taffer.
Yeah.
Is that alive? That's alive. Clean it up. So I watch a lot of late night TV, and was that a good impression, or was that a...
Oh, yeah.
That was good. Yeah, you were the only one with me on it.
You dropped a log on it.
Dropped a log on it, yeah. That'd be a show. I watch late night TV, and now I just kind of... I like doing it because of the commercials. You know, like, we all see those commercials, like,
like those, like, did you or a close family member take this pill and experience, you know, loss of movement in your legs, blindness, or like uncontrollable bowel movements or deafness. And I get so bored, I just call the number, and I, when someone answers, I just go, ah! What happened, man? I can't hear you, but I'm pissing everywhere. Hang up. Man, that's some shitty writing. I said that one on the ride here, and I was like, no one's gonna laugh, but you guys are my fucking people. Hell yeah, that's what I'm talking about. There's about 13 of you. I'll get, now I'm gonna finally have 13 Twitter followers. Nice, this is. I do have a lot of anxiety, though, I do. It's annoying, but my therapist asked me, you know, what's been going on with you, and I just, well, it's not just anxiety. My OCD acts up, my anxiety kicks in, which brings me down because I have a little bit of depression caused by all the anxiety, and but I do my best not to worry about it. So she asked me if I had any tools to cope with all my anxiety, and I said, yeah, I got some tools, a six-pack and a joint. And she said, well, what about when you get depressed? Do you have any tools that'll be depression? I said, yes, a six-pack and a joint. So then she prescribed me Xanax, and I said to her, you really want me to take that with a six-pack and a joint? All right, let's party. I've had a lot of jobs as a comedian. You guys are probably thinking this guy's made it, but... You need money? I know this because I did my research. I actually went to MSN.com the other day. I saw a link. It said, can you retire when you're broke? I clicked on the link and said, nope. I just feel like the job application process is a little unfair to begin with, you know? That was actually for your job history. It's like, I live in the now. You know what I mean? Yeah, forget those other jobs. You know what I mean? Let's move on, you know? That was actually for three references. I only have two parents. It's like, it's not fair. I was on an interview recently, and the lady asked me if I had my degree. I got excited. I was like, yeah, I got my business management degree. She's like, oh, you got your four-year degree? I'm like, no, it took me seven. It's like, it took you 7 years to get your bachelor's degree? I'm like, whoa. Slow down, it's just my associates. 2 year. I forgot I was, when I'm in Maine, I have to say 2 years. I've had a lot of jobs, but I work at a grocery store now, and I gotta admit it's not my passion. Luckily though, they did start me out at $8.30 because I'm experienced. Yeah. Worked at a grocery store when I was 15 years old, and I'm almost 30 now. Because I feel like sometimes in life you just know. I was pushing carts the other day, and one of my regular customers came up to me and said, you know what, Paul? You just went back to school and got your degree. You can make more money and never push a cart again in your life. I said, I'm sorry, I'm actually not allowed to accept tips. They get worse. when I came back in from pushing carts, they wanted me to fill a suggestion sheet on how I could improve the job. I said, I wish when I was pushing carts outside, I could listen to my headphones, you know? And one of my coworkers said, well, then, Paul, you're not going to hear when the cars are coming. I said, that's the fucking point. I was working the register at the grocery store the other day, and I had a lady come through my line, actually asked me how I was doing for a change. I said, I'm doing good. She said, you can only be doing well. You cannot be doing good. So tell me, how are you doing? I said, well, not good. I'm Paul Landworth, guys. Thank you so much for having me. Bring it back to Ryan Chitty.
Very excited to bring up the next comic. She actually runs a great room down in Austin, Mass. It's Comedy Night at Pavement. It's Fridays at 6:30. If anyone wants to go down there, she's getting some good up-and-coming comics, even national acts going down there free. I know you guys like that. You can do this one. So, ride that on here. Let's give a round of applause for Pamela Ross.
Oh, what a goddamn nightmare. How are you guys? How are you doing? Holy shit, Manchester. All right. Okay. So I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I have a bachelor's in English and a master's in communication, so I'm unemployed. Thank you. I've been reading through a lot of job listings, and there's one phrase you'll always read over and over. We work hard, but we play even harder. Like they're whispering you a naughty secret, but that's just a passive-aggressive way of saying, we're going to work you so hard, you're going to need a way to forget about it. They're just daring you to take up a vice, right? But you can't drink at work, or so I was told in my last exit interview. So how do you cope with the stresses of white-collar labor? You have two major options as I see it. You can make like Allison from Intervention and huff keyboard cleaner. I think you laughed hardest, so you're my new best friend. Hello. So good to, you know, you're welcome, and I'm sorry for my friendship. Or you can do what I used to do, drop everything, go into the break room, do shots of Dairy Creamer until you feel something, right? But be warned, if you do that, Fran from marketing will confront you. Fran, don't talk to me. Statistically, it is almost impossible that your grandchildren are that special. I don't give a shit. I don't care. I realized through this job search process, I'm not an ambitious person, okay? All my girlfriends now are like, I don't know if I want to be a doctor or a lawyer or a scientist. And I'm like, samesies. I don't know if I want to be a second wife or a stay-at-home not mom or just sell my used panties on Craigslist for rent money. So right there with you, sisters. Feminism, lean in, etc. I'm right there with you. You can probably just tell from my voice that I'm from Connecticut. I think I have that Connecticut accent, where no matter what I say, it sounds condescending. Right? And if you don't know what I mean, then you probably went to a state school. So it's okay if you did, I won't tell. I'm from a part of Connecticut it's so white that sometimes the white people there don't recognize that I'm also a white person. They think I'm like Puerto Rican or some shit, which I know makes no sense. I can't believe that I'd have to defend my whiteness. Like, I'm a white woman. I have 2 communications degrees and a benign strain of HPV. So I think I've proven that. I'm in my first real adult relationship, so thank you for the rapturous applause. You're as confident in the future of my relationship as I am. And people always feel entitled to give me advice that I didn't ask for. They're like, sometimes you just have to pretend to like what your boyfriend likes. It's easier that way. I don't have to pretend. I love large-breasted Asian women. It's just my preference. That's what got you? Asian breasts? All right, great. We're really in a comic book store. Who here loves hentai? I'm raising both hands, you just can't tell. I had my first real pregnancy scare recently. Yeah, so it's official, I'm a woman. I know that sounds like a rough initiation into womanhood, but it was still easier than trying to learn the Hebrew alphabet. So, no regrets. Not a lot of Jews in Manchester, I get it. You're like, no, we have a small but sizable Jewish population. Let me tell you about the demographics. I'll Google it, it's fine. Man, my boyfriend was freaking out, saying like, can you imagine what it would be like if we had a baby? Because you would just have to stay at home all day with the baby, and I'd have to work, and you would have nothing to do but watch daytime TV and smoke medicinal marijuana. I was like, babe, you're right. We have to be a lot less careful. Because that is my dream. That's my American dream, okay? Just to vape and watch The View. And I assume the baby would be doing the same. I don't know a lot about childcare. Trying to keep this just vacant, okay? Not for renting or buying. That'd be bad. I actually have been thinking a lot about birth control recently. Not to go on it, obviously. Not to go on it. But I thought there was one brand of birth control pill called The Pill. I thought that's what everyone was popping like Molly, but no, there are many different brand names of birth control pills. I'll give you a few of them, see if you notice a pattern. Okay, Violette, Cyclas, Nordette, Zara. Why are they all named after strippers? Why stripper names all along? That doesn't make sense to me. Like, maybe it was a marketing strategy, like a chicken or egg thing. Like, all right, what reminds people of doing it? Dirty strippers. Or did they think, who needs this the most? Dirty strippers. But they're not too smart, so put their names directly on the pill. I don't know. They're trying to make a male version of the birth control pill that dudes could take. And I was thinking, what would they name those after? Not strippers, because male strippers are not as commonplace. But maybe like, I don't know, cast members of Sons of Anarchy. You're like, yeah, I like that show. I'm a guy, it's pretty good. Or maybe professional athletes who have murdered people. Or that one upset you, I see. We won't go with that one. Or don't know. I gotta think about it. I do hope that happens, though, so I can continue to be responsible as a sexually active adult. I didn't feel super confident when I first moved to Boston when it came to the whole, like, dating thing. I know, you're like, that's so crazy. This woman is, like, so gorgeous and perfect. But I didn't feel confident. I had, like, a really shitty boyfriend in high school. He wasn't really my boyfriend. He was my guy friend who I met doing theater, and he would, like, inexpertly finger me in the light booth during rehearsal. You know when you get something stuck in a vending machine? And you're like, God damn it. I need this Twix bar. It's 3 p.m. I had a terrible boyfriend in college. So I got here and I didn't feel, I was like, no one's gonna wanna date me. Then I was waiting for the tea and this cute guy asked me out. I couldn't believe it. Instantly in my head, I'm like, oh, they're gonna make a movie about my life. It's gonna be like a classic rom-com. I'm gonna be played by Anne Hathaway and my love interest will be played by, like, you know, Ryan Gosling. But I know, like, in real life, if they made that film, given like the age gaps we've been seeing in Hollywood, like, I would be played by a 9-year-old girl they just found wandering the Warner Brothers lot, and my love interest would be probably James Gandolfini's corpse. You know, like, it wouldn't be like an adorable rom-com. It would be horrifying. But we went on a date, and he was pretty cute, okay? Because I'm not into conventionally handsome men. I like guys who look kind of like yard sale art, you know, like, they're fixer-uppers, all right? You're like, I'll slap a new frame on this. I won't look at it too hard. It'll seem like an original Degas print. We went on a date, and we just had nothing in common. We had nothing. Like, he was a good person. He went to church every Sunday. Meanwhile, I had been the only practicing Wiccan at my Catholic middle school. Just, like, fundamental opposites. Like, it just wasn't working. We went to a sports bar, and they were televising the Winter Olympics, and the event was male figure skating. I was so excited. I've only followed 2 sports in my life, okay? Figure skating and rhythmic gymnastics. And that's true, because I like sports for the artistry, okay? That's why I'm into them. That seems reasonable to you. I like any sport where not only do you have to wear a costume, but your score is based partly on how beautiful the costume is, okay? So this guy pointed at the screen and was like, figure skating is queer. I thought to myself, that's redundant. Like, why fucking bother saying that? So then I just, like, fucking swan dove into a cab and ran away. So it didn't work out. This is a true thing about me. My favorite thing to do in Boston is karaoke. Any karaoke fans in the house? Oh, yeah. You're like, I'm open to anything. I love that. That's so positive. It's not relatable to me, but it's so positive. I love that. It's my favorite thing to do in Boston. But the last time I went, it was so awkward because there was a huge office party and they were trying to get the one black guy in their office to do a rap song, which is so inappropriate. And they, like, weren't subtle about it either. They were like, Deshaun, you should do a rap song. You should do a rippity rap. And he was like, my name's Neil. All right, thank you so much. Thank you, Manchester. Bye.
The next guy coming up. He's good. I enjoy him. I enjoy him. He's actually, if you do like him, or if you're like, you know what? I want to see him a lot more. Next month, he's the comic in residence down at the Comedy Studio in Harvard Square, playing every night of the week besides the nights they don't have it, which are only Mondays. So you got a good chance of seeing him. His name is Jared Palopolo, everybody. Thank you very much.
All right. Hello, Manchester. Hello, sexy audience. I can't see you, but I'm giving you the benefit of the doubt. my name is Jared Palopolo. I know it's an odd name in this all-white room, but it's just, I wish I had any other name. Like, any other name would be cool. Like, sir, what's your name?
Henry.
Henry, see, that's a classic name, very, like, old school, master, like a muscle car playing a Prince song, very cool. Sir, what's yours?
Pete.
So that's a cool name, too. It's like a Prince song about a muscle car. I only know 2 things. Prince songs and muscle cars. That's the only things I don't know. This is a first for me, doing a comic book store. Pamela was talking about strippers. This summer, I went to my first strip club. Yeah. Yeah, you can, yeah, if you want. Turns out I'm more of an aquarium guy. drove up to Montreal, Canada to go to a strip club because we, my shame knows no bounds, but it understands international borders. But we got to the club. I didn't want a lap dance, so my whole night was these strippers coming up to me one by one and being like, hey, do you want me to strip you and get naked? And after three, I just felt like I was at a target and all of the employees were trying to help me. Like, are you looking for something? No, I'm just looking. I don't want anything. Went with my friends, I'll change their names to protect the innocent. One of my friends, John and Rohan Padje of New York. And he's on Facebook, he's a handsome man. But like, when we got there, John was like, hey everybody, it's Rohan's bachelor party. Which is like a white lie, it's, you know, makes it more festive. But then after Rohan got a lap dance, he was like, guess what? It's also John's bachelor party, which is like the worst lie he could have told. Because that's like, that means that we were at a double bachelor party with three attendees. Like, they were like, I'm getting married too. Let's have a bachelor party. Let's invite all of our friends. Cut to, it's just the three of us. Hey, we're taking your car or let's take both cars. I'm so sad now. Oh man, we went to two strip clubs. Well, we thought the first place was a strip club because it had a lot of great Yelp reviews, which is not, this is the first time we're not strip club people, that we went to Yelp. But like, the first place we went to was a brothel. Turns out it was an accident. We like went up there, went to this place, it was called Pussy Core. Like they kept saying it out loud all day, and I was like, that makes sense. Because soft core, hardcore, pussy core, the hardest of cores, duh. But then we got there, and it's like spelled CORPS like a military outfit. The least sexy thing you can attach pussy to. And we go in there, and there aren't any strippers. It's just blackness, like this room, but an old man standing like right at the entrance, and he just goes, gentlemen, our business is sex. And then some strippers come out, but I'm just like, yeah, it's called Pussy Core. What else would your business be? It can only be three things. It can be a brothel. It could be an all-night cat store. Or my favorite Ben & Jerry's flavor ever. Well, the guy like does this and all these women come out and they make like a semicircle around me and my friends and they just start trying to pose sexy. Like they all had these, each one had a different pose. Like one was like pushing her breasts together, letting them fall. Like, one of these times I'm gonna be gravity. But one was like cocking her hips. Like, if only somebody would keep it in place. And then one was doing this weird thing with her arm just, I will also have drugs. I don't know. It's like they all learned how to be sexy from Grand Theft Auto. We just turned and left. And I'm thankful. Like, if any of my friends on that trip had, like, gone and, like, bought a hooker, I would have judged them. Like, most people I wouldn't judge. I think it should be perfectly fine to buy a hooker unless you're between the ages of 25 and 35. Because, like, under 25, it's like, okay, that's a great, like, can you believe that time kind of story? Over 35, you've lived a little. Take a shortcut. In between, it's just like, you're in the prime of your life. Just put in some effort. Or put in less effort. You're probably being creepy. That's probably the problem. Probably too much effort. Let's see. You guys like movies?
Yeah.
Yeah, you like movies? Anyway, a horror movie?
Yeah.
I love them. I love horror movies. I love close-up shots on elaborate doorknobs. It's really... Oh, that's what really gets me going. Not strippers, just doorknobs. I've been watching all the, like, the interviews and stuff about Jared Leto playing the Joker next time they have a Joker in a movie. And I'm like, just calm down. Because everything they talk about is like how intense he's going. Like, we had to have a psychologist on set in case this movie was too intense for the actors. Or like, he'd give these weird gifts to his co-stars. And it's like, calm down, dude. You're playing a murder clown. Like, like Robert De Niro became a taxi driver to be in the movie Taxi Driver. And Mickey Rourke learn how to be a professional wrestler to play a wrestler. You don't have to be a murder clown to play a murder clown. This is not a real thing. We would all, like, they're all being, like, so, in, like, he's so intense. He's so in the role. He's like, Will Smith is like, I've never met the real Jared Leto. It's like, calm down. We would all, like, be weirded out if they were like, Josh Brolin is playing Thanos. And then he's like, to prepare for this role, I'm going to go into space for 3 years. You're really fucking bullshit. I used to work in a video store. It was great. I was just never good at customer service. It's like there was this one time, a young couple, a young guy and a girl came in, and they were like, oh, the girl was like, so we're on a date night, and we're looking for a horror movie for our date. Can you recommend something for us? And in my head, I was like, yeah, I just spent the last 5 hours putting up posters for Spy Kids 3D. That's the only horror I know now. That's my Vietnam. But, like, I happened to be holding a stack of movies in my hand, and the top one was a movie I had not seen at the time. It was a movie called The Last House on the Left. That's the right result. I see where this story is going. The story is not going anywhere good. I was like, this is a horror movie. Here we go. All I knew is it was a horror movie. It was directed by Wes Craven. He's a good director. Hand it over. Then if you haven't seen Last House on the Left, here's a spoiler alert for a 40-year-old movie. Here's what happens. Two young girls about the same age as the girl in this story go out into the woods for some summer fun, and then they get murdered for 60 minutes. Just nonstop, brutal, just awful. Like, here's how bad the movie is. A friend told me that they had intended on making a porn movie, and then they were like, it would make more money if it was a horror movie, so they just turned all the sex scenes into rape scenes on purpose. Like, they didn't just go into editing and be like, ah, shit, she's frowning in every shot. How do we fix this? It's the last movie you want to watch on a date night. Like, on a date, if you watch a horror movie on a date night, you want something that's like, whoa, that cat sure came out of nowhere. You don't want something that's like, the nature of man is a temporary skin wrapped around a permanent darkness. Like, that's that movie. So I give this movie to them, and I do feel bad because I just threw it at them. Because they came back, instead of like sliding in the mail slot to return it, they like came into the store and waited by the entrance and just stood there while I was like wiping down a counter, and I'm about to be like, hey, how was the movie? But before I could even get my hand up, the girl just yells, that was fucked up, and left. She walks out the door, the guy stands just for 20 seconds, just long enough for me to see the most drained, sad look I've ever seen on a man's face. Because, Henry, I don't know if you've ever had a blowjob stolen from you. Your face fucking freezes. Guys, that being said, blah, blah, good night. Thank you very much.
Next guy coming up, man, one of my favorites around here, best looking man in red pants this side of Manchester. And if you like his stuff, which I know you will, his CD's right back there. It's called Come On Feel Chanoin. Let's give it up for Jay Chanoin.
Thank you, guys. I was watching that thing falling this entire show. I was just like, this room is haunted by the angriest nerd right now. And I was just like, that is not what this room is intended for. Somebody better talk about Yu-Gi-Oh. I am so happy to be here because whenever I do real comedy shows, the host will be like, how do you want me to bring you up? And I'll be like, I want you to say that I'm a level 5 half-elf rogue. And they'll be like, no, I'm not going to say that. I'm like, just say clubs and colleges then. That's the standard intro. Yeah, in case you couldn't tell, I'm the first person on the mic who has been in this building before for a reason other than to visit my uncle. That's, I've never been here for that. Yeah. I do appreciate that a couple of you have tried to cater it to the crowd, though. That's nice. Nerds love that. Jer worked on a little joker talk. companies when internet porn. That's smart. Know your audience. That's there are 10 people here. I bet we could make a list of 100 porn actresses by name in about 5 minutes if we tried. It's a big thing. Happy to be here. I'm always happy to be on the East Coast in New England. That's where I'm from. I was on tour earlier this year. Did a tour of the South with a friend of mine. And I started in Austin, Texas. I'd never been there. It was an awesome place. But I did my show in Austin. And afterwards, four dudes came up to me. And they all had advice for me. It was the same advice. They didn't come together independently. They all said the same thing. They said, hey, while you're here, don't tell that joke about Dunkin' Donuts because we don't have them. And later, I was telling this story in another part of Texas, and this girl yelled out, bullshit, we have them. I was like, bullshit, you don't have them like we do. Because you know how many I saw on the drive over there? Zero. If we were in New England, I would have seen 17 of them. Like, there would have been one in the bar that we were at. We'd all be drinking iced coffee, and we'd all fucking hate each other. That's another East Coast thing that they do not do. So I was like, I'll explain it to you this way, Texas. We have Dunkin' Donuts the way you have Mexicans. They are fucking everywhere. They're part of our heritage. Please don't mess with them, that type of thing. But no, I got upset when those guys told me that. They were like, you're upset. Why? Because you want to tell that joke? I was like, no, I'm upset because where am I going to get my fucking Dunkin' Donuts? They are everywhere for a reason. They don't close. Have you ever seen a closed Dunkin' Donuts? We keep all of them open. We just drink enough to sustain. And I'm not going to a Starbucks because I'm not a fucking douchebag. It's not an option. I don't want you to write my name on the cup and spell it wrong. I want you to write my order on the cup and make it wrong. That's what I'm used to. That's what I like. And I want to pay $3 for it. I'm not mad when it's wrong because $3. I'm not paying $7 for a cup of coffee. I would rather buy a bottle of no-dose, give it to a trucker, and have him pee in my mouth. I honestly think that's my better option. I also found out while I was down south, no one knows where New Hampshire is. No one has any idea. My favorite response I got to, I'm from New Hampshire, was, is that a state? It's like, no, it's two towns over, asshole. I'm here all the time. No, they don't. So I had to explain. I was like, I'm from a place called Manchester, New Hampshire. It's a quote-unquote city. You know, we call it a city, but it's not. We're not far from Boston. We've all been there. Probably most of you have been in New York. I was born just outside of Detroit before they turned it into a real-life Mad Max theme park. I have seen real cities, is my point. I know what they look like. Manchester's not that. Manchester's the type of place where I can go, this is my town, and no one gets upset because no one else wants to claim it. I have a friend who's from here. He moved down to Boston. I went to visit him. At one point, he said that. He goes, this is my town. I was like, no, it fucking isn't. This is Boston, Massachusetts. No one can say that. The mayor of Boston could go, this is my town. There would still be a guy going, no, it ain't. I fingered your sister, you fucking prick. Boston is that guy's town. There are a million of him there. They're all Mark Wahlberg. It's very weird. Boston's a weird place, or at least that's what I told Arkansas, and I think they believe it now, which is awesome. My sister just had a kid, and they were doing the whole, what are we going to name the baby thing? Not now, he's 3 months old, but like before, they were, what are we going to name the baby? And just everyone wants to have like a unique baby name now, like something that's, and there aren't any. They don't exist anymore. You end up with shit like, oh, our name's Nevaeh, it's heaven spelled backwards. Like, that's a weird way to tell your kid her life's going to be hell. I think she would have figured that out on her own. But no, there aren't any more unique names. If you really want a name that is just your kids, the only way I see that we can do it is we need to start naming kids the same way we pick Twitter handles. I think that's the only way. What do you want to name him? Mark Smith? Yeah, that's taken. He can be Mark Smith 283. If you want to do that. Or Boner Fart 69. That's still available. Maybe it's not. I've met a few bows in my life. They never told me if it was short for anything. That might be taken. But no, if we do that, there's like a great thing that actually happens. You know, when you're growing up, you're like, man, I wonder what my parents were like before I was born. You don't wonder that anymore when your name is Juggalo for life, whoop whoop, with zeros for O's. You know exactly what your parents were like. You had a bottle full of Faygo. They were pieces of shit. By the way, guys, if you hear someone refer to something as The Gathering, they're either talking about Magic, the card game, or of the Juggalos. And either way, you can assume there are troll swamps and body odor involved. Yeah, take that, other way more lucrative thing this room is normally used for. That's... Normally, at the end of that joke, I'm like, I'm sorry if there's any juggalos in the crowd. I'm not sorry if you play Magic the Gathering. I'm really sorry if you play Magic the Gathering. And I just told that joke. Normally, I'm like, you're not going to do shit. I know, because I used to play. You might fucking do something here, and I am scared. It was the first time I've ever been afraid to tell that fucking joke. Usually a comedy night, like on a weeknight, is at a bar, and there's always like at least five dudes who just want to be at the bar, who are like, God, I wish I didn't have to listen to this. And I was so certain that there were going to be three poor kids here just trying to tap some forests and shit. And then I'm going to come up and tell that joke, and they're going to be like, fucking asshole. I just trying to fucking play. I dropped out of high school. A lot of people are surprised to find that out, which I take as a compliment. I'm glad that you don't just look at me and go, there's no way you finished even the most basic level of education. I'm glad people don't assume that. But no, I dropped out of high school. And right after I did, there was like a 2-month period where I didn't have a job and I wasn't going to school. So I just did nothing. Like I sat at home and I got high and I played GameCube while I was waiting for my friends to get out of school. And that got boring after like a week. So I somehow found out that my lunch card had not been canceled yet from my school. So around lunchtime, I would walk over to the high school that I used to go to. I would sit with my friends and I would eat free lunch. And then I would just go home. I did this for like 2 weeks. And I would be frivolous with my spending too, because now I don't need this money to last me any period of time anymore. I get two lunches, fuck it. Right? Hey, that cute girl at the end, tell her chicken fries are on me. Yeah, throw in some fucking fruit snacks. I don't give a shit. I am lunch card balling right now. Let's fucking do this. But so one day, I go, I'm getting like my third sandwich, and I come out, and one of my old teachers was on lunch duty. She comes up to me and she goes, Jay, you're back. And I go, yes, I'm back. For those of you not paying attention, I was not back. I was still done. And she was like, are you back for good? Or are you like dropping something off? Like, what? I was like, no, I'm here. This is it. I'm back for good. She was like, that's great. And I'm walking away and I was like, man, that was a close one. And then I realized, no, it was not. That was not a close. What the fuck are they going to do? Yeah, I can't get detention. I can't get sent to the... I don't even go here anymore. Even if they figure out that I am not supposed to be here, they don't know what to do next. They've never had this problem before. There's never been a meeting where they were like, how do we keep kids from coming here? We need to... It was the most liberating freedom I have ever felt. Quitting is awesome. It feels so good. The closest I've ever been able to get to that day as an adult is once in a while I'll wake up, I'll put on a collared shirt and some khakis, I'll just drive to Old Navy and start folding shit. For like 2 hours, wait till it's crowded and then just throw the cargo pants on the floor and be like, I've had it! Walk up to the front desk with middle fingers flying and be like, take this job and shove it, I quit! I gotta go because I can't be late to work again this week. People get really confused, but it feels good. It feels wonderful. I don't have a DVD player in my bedroom, so what I am forced to do is use my PlayStation 4 video game console. All right, it's two PlayStation 2s stacked on top of each other, but whatever. You guys are going to make me be so honest. No, I have a PS2 in my bedroom, and those come from the factory with these preset parental control settings, where if you try to watch a movie that is inappropriate, it'll make you put in a parental access code before you can watch that movie. And that happened to me one day. Popped up, it was like, you need to put in a code before you can watch. Back to the Future. What? Mind you guys, this was on my PlayStation. I used this to play Grand Theft Auto, where I walk up to strangers, shoot them in the face, mutilate their corpse with a chainsaw. No warning there. Jump right in and play. But when I want to go back in time with Marty McFly, Sony's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Are you sure you want to allow this filth into your home? Wouldn't your time be better spent with some wholesome fun, like stealing a school bus, filling it with hookers, bringing them to the park, and hunting them with a shotgun? Everyone knows the soundtrack to A Bad Decision is Huey Lewis and the News. Everyone knows that. Oh man, I was on the internet the other day and saw an ad for an article. It was called 25 Hilarious Autocorrect Fails. And I clicked on it, and it wasn't really an article. It was a series of pictures with captions. But fuck it, that passes for an article nowadays. As well it should. I mean, we already live in a world where you can download a Domino's Pizza app to your phone, press a couple buttons, order your pizza over the internet. But wait, if you don't want to press those buttons, now you can just use your phone's voice recognition. Speak your order. It'll translate it, place the order over the internet. Isn't that so convenient? Yeah, you know, like a fucking telephone. You could use that same thing to just call Domino's and say, I want pizza, and they would bring it to you. But no, we've evolved past that. We don't speak to other human beings anymore. What we want is to just sit in one place, have a tiny screen that does everything for us, and move closer to our eventual goal of being fatter, dumber versions of Stephen Hawking. That's what we all seem to want. Is he here? Did I just offend somebody? While we're on the topic, hey, Stephen, when are you going to get a new voice? I think it's time. I'm sure that was impressive like 30 years ago. Technology has evolved. You sound terrifying. Everyone here, if any of you bought a GPS tomorrow and it sounded like that, like, in a quarter mile, enter the traffic circle, you would return it. You'd be like, this thing's a piece of shit. And why wouldn't you? You can get another one and make it sound like Samuel L. Jackson. Of course you want that. Turn right, motherfucker. I want that. That is awesome. That's just a GPS. This is the smartest man on the face of the planet. Why does he sound like I dropped a Teddy Ruxpin in a bathtub? It makes no sense to me. So the article was 25 hilarious autocorrect fails. Number 6 is so funny. And I clicked it, because I always do. Like, where's number 6? That's mediocre at best. Who's clicking this shit? I just fell for it. It happens every time. So I scroll down. Number 6, actually very funny. Autocorrect fail. Text from dad. Says, do you want to come over for dinner tomorrow night? We're eating your mom's pussy. Then he goes, oh my God, I meant pot pie. Why did my phone do that? And I was like, touche, BuzzFeed. Very funny, but it's funny because no phone comes pre-programmed with the word pussy in it, you guys. Your dad taught his phone that word. Because all he uses it for is Google image search, pussy. Pornhub search, pussy. Text your mom, I want to eat your pussy. She could have been making hamburgers that night. When he hit H, it still would have suggested pussy. Because it's the only word he writes on there. My point is, the opposite never happened. No dude's ever gone to jerk off and accidentally watched a video of hot, wet pot pie. That has never happened. That's not a problem people have. It was very difficult for me to grow up to be this. I was raised in a strict born-again Christian household, and I was not allowed to play the awesome, violent video games that to this day I like to play. One day I came home from school, and Mom told me I wasn't allowed to play Mortal Kombat anymore. I was like, did Jesus have something to do with this? I'll bet he did. That guy ruins everything. And he did. She showed me an article in a Christian magazine warning parents, do not let your kids play this game. Because in the Midwest, there was a kid who played it a lot. And they claimed that was what made him lose touch with reality, which caused him to bring a steak knife to school, stab his classmate 26 times, and try to eat him. Yeah, to this day, not fully convinced that his favorite video game has as much to do with his murder as they want us to think it did. That's not in the game, guys. No steak knives in Mortal Kombat. Did he even say finish him? Because, like, if he didn't, you got no case whatsoever. But it didn't matter what I said. Decision had been made. I was upset, but I figured out a way out of it. The next day, I brought a crucifix to school, nailed a classmate to it, and I was like, learn that from too much church. Can we stop doing that now, too? Flawless victory. That's why we call that one. A lot of my friends tell me I have an amazing memory. They're like, oh my God, you remember so much stuff. And I really don't. I have a useless memory. Nothing that I will ever need is up here. It's all useless shit, you know? And my brain just goes, basic math, we don't need that. Get rid of it. We need that room so we can remember the commercials for Muzzy. A series of VHS tapes from the late 80s that taught your kids how to speak foreign languages. And you know they worked because I didn't have them. I only saw the commercials. And to this day, I can say two things in French. I can say, I am a little girl. Je suis la jeune fille. And I can say, 1, 2, 3, 4. I don't know why brain decided to hold on to that for the last 25 years. Just in case I decide to start a transsexual French-speaking Ramones cover band. Now I have that option. I'm not going to do that. I could name you maybe 8 state capitals before Google got involved, but in one breath I can tell you that NyQuil's the nighttime sniffling, sneezing, coughing, aching stuff. You have fever so you can rest medicine. That's good to know. I gotta have that. Even that slogan, though, which seems so long, in my opinion, not long enough. They left a lot out of that description. If you have ever taken NyQuil, you'll agree. It's more like the nighttime sniffling, sneezing, coughing, aching, stuffy head fever so you can rest and wake up feeling like you got dosed with a hybrid of a date rape drug and the worst acid that has ever been brewed in someone's bathtub. Like, all your childhood fears were unleashed. They tap dance across your subconscious all night. Wake up, you feel like you're moving underwater. You just hobble to the bathroom. Stare in the mirror and touch your face for like 8 minutes. You don't know why you're doing it, but you can't stop. Finally, some reality creeps in and you're like, I cannot go to work like this. This is so much worse than if I just had a scratchy throat, so now I gotta call out. I guess I'll take another dose and spend the day dreaming that my grandfather's the tour manager of a ska band of skeletons. Madison. Yeah. My point is, hey Vix, why don't you save me a little room in my memory? Let's just make that slogan NyQuil. If you're starting to get sick, why not get totally fucked up instead? It's way more fun. A girl that I know recently was oversharing, and she told me that she hates to give her boyfriend blowjobs. It's about to get dirty. In an effort to make this more enjoyable for herself, she covered his nether regions in brownie batter. Yeah. All right, first things first, you know she's seen whipped cream. Like, if you're old enough to give a blowjob, you've come across a couple of your other options before you arrive at the 15 minutes of prep time involved in brownies and multiple ingredients. You need a shopping list to give this blowjob. When I was like, did that make it better? She said, oh, it was incredible. Really? Did he enjoy it? No, not really. Oh, well, what kind of weirdo are you dating, man? Who doesn't want their genitals slathered in a thick, fudgy coating like you're about to get to third base with a Keebler elf? There's nothing creepy about that. What bothers me the most about this is, where is the romanticism? This is supposed to be an act of passion. That is gone the moment you walk in the bedroom with a spatula, like, oh baby, gonna treat you, right? Well, once you put your dick in this Twinkie, it's the only way I don't find it repulsive. That's not spicing up your sex life at that point, guys. That's spicing up a snack cake commercial. That's all that is. Just, hey, where's the cream filling? Bent. Now that's the stuff. That's like the 7th 15-year-old commercial that I've referenced in this set. I'll tell you guys one more thing. As I mentioned, I was raised in a born-again Christian household, and a lot of my friends are surprised to find that out, especially surprised to find out how much I know about the Bible. I've retained a lot of that information. I've read it, and you know what? It's an all right book, official opinion. As far as fantasy goes, it's okay. It's a little preachy, haha. Hell of an ending, holy shit. Ending's fucking awesome. Everyone dies. It's like Joss Whedon wrote it. It is fantastic. I love it. But my favorite Bible story, you guys probably don't know, it's not on the Bible's greatest hits, so I will tell it to you now. David and King Saul's daughter are very much in love. King Saul says, hey, David, if you want to marry my daughter, you have X amount of time. Go out. Get me 100 foreskins. David goes, totally. Now, let's pause. This is a real Bible story. I'm not making this up. And the first question we should ask is, why is this not better known? Like, how awesome would it be if the opposing side of the gay marriage debate was going, the Bible says one man, one woman, 100 bleeding penises. That is the way it's supposed to be. So David agrees to this. He's like, absolutely, I will do that. He goes out, just starts murdering and collecting phallic scalps, like killing dudes, stealing their foreskin. He gets to 200, and then he realizes, shit, I only needed 100 of these. Oops, brings him to King Saul, marries his daughter, the end, I guess? I don't know. The Bible leaves a lot of questions unanswered here. Probably the biggest one? What the fuck, man? What the fuck am I reading? What is this? The Book of 1 Samuel Special Victims Unit? Why is that in the Bible? How do you accidentally end up with 100 extra foreskins? Was it just way easier than he thought it was going to be? Like 20 minutes in, he's like, I have 68. I bet I could get 200. I'm going for the record. Or did he just get really caught up in cock chopping? Like Eye of the Tiger started playing and he's got swept up in the moment. Why are you doing this? Because I love her, snicked. That's a Wolverine sound effect for you guys. What did he do with the extra 100? Did he throw them in as a bonus and say, like, I bet you thought I wasn't going to get these. Here's twice as many. Or did he hold on to them in case he runs into this situation again where someone uses that as currency? And then every time his wife cleans the house, she's like, seriously, can we get rid of the foreskins now? No one's ever going to want these. He's like, really? Because your dad wanted 100 of them. I don't know why. I didn't want to ask. Maybe he's making the world's grossest macaroni necklace. Maybe he's collecting them for a fucked up game of Pogs. Look, I don't get this either. But apparently that's a thing that some people want. By the way, do you know what I had to do to get those? Because I don't care how many romantic comedies you've seen. Tom Hanks never did that shit for Meg Ryan. So if you'll excuse me, I have to go to therapy to cope with the fact that for the rest of eternity, I'll be in the Bible as the dude who mutilated 200 dicks. Thank you very much, you guys.
That's fun. So we have our headliner coming. One guy left.
Here we go!
Yes! So he runs Great Room over at Chaskeen every Wednesday night. Got national headliners coming through for the cheap payment of zero, just a couple beers, you know. And you can see he's been featured over at Laugh Factory in both Chicago and Hollywood. Let's give it up here for Mr. Nick LaValle.
I love following Jay Shinoin at a comic book shop. That's a real fucking good idea. Like, Jay Shinoin looks like a guy who became a superhero, and he was inspired to become that superhero because he was fucking bullied by a guy who looked like me. Wow, I feel like he's just like break through the wall and kick my ass now with some superpower. This is fun. How are you, sir? You look fucking great.
Thank you.
I look fucking great too. I feel fantastic. I did a bunch of cocaine in the bathroom. This is great. Sorry, Brett. I'm actually really psyched to be here. I can't believe Brett just excused my priors. Normally, I'm not allowed anywhere near here or Chuck E. Cheese, so this is cool. You know, you have to have a child to go to Chuck E. Cheese. Did you know that? Like, you go to Chuck E. Cheese, and it says there's. I went there, and there's a sign that said you must be accompanied by a minor to enter this building. And I told the bouncer at Chuck E. Cheese, I was like, if I already had a minor, why the fuck would I go to Chuck E. Cheese? Like, I'm not disturbed. We're not fucking swingers. I do love being like a New England dude. I wish I could just say I'm from New Hampshire and people know where that is. Like, I think New Hampshire is some of the coolest places in the world. Like, Laconia, New Hampshire is the only place on the planet where you're gonna fight with a biker and a 12-year-old over the same skee ball machine. Like, I was up there last summer, I think I'm kicking ass, right? I'm playing skee ball and I'm winning all these tickets. So I turned to the 12-year-old next to me. I was like, dude, you must be jealous. He's like, jealous of what? I was like, look at all these tickets that I've won. This kid looks at me, he's like, dude, I got way more tickets than you. So I get defensive. First thing I said was, fuck you, because I'm from Manchganistan, and that's how we talk to children. I was like, dude, I'm in my 30s, man. I could drink beer, drive a car. I could have sex with women. This kid looks at me, he goes, yeah, you could, but you're at Fun Spot playing skee ball with a fucking 12-year-old. So him and I are Facebook friends now, which is also super dope. He's cool. Sends me all the cheat codes. My parents aren't very proud of me, but they are proud of my little brother. Like, my little brother has a very unique profession. He's a dancer. He's a Broadway actor, dancer, super talented. But he sounds like that New England townie character from the Ben Affleck movie that I mentioned before. Like my brother, like, he'll call me and be like, "Fucking dude, I got the pot." I'm like, well, what fucking pot did you get? He's like, in the fucking movie. Why do you think I need those pink fucking ballerina slippers, dude? Like, that's my little brother. Like, he just breaks all these stereotypes of, like, what it would mean to be, like, a theater actor. But he is, like, he's a Broadway dancer, and there's, like, no one better to party with than Broadway dudes. And this is what I learned from him. Like, if you want to get wicked, you fucking do it with the cast of Wicked. If you wanna chase pussy, you do it with the cast of Cats. Like, these guys, like, party. Like, I don't know if... Are you guys familiar with Billy Elliot at all? A little bit. My little brother was in the cast of Billy Elliot, and these fuckers drank me under the table, and half of them are like 12 years old. Like, this was crazy. I went to the show, and I was like partying with them, and I had to cut out early, so I went back to the hotel early, and I passed out, only to get woken up at 4 in the morning by like shit getting thrown. There was water running. I heard two Mexicans fighting in the room, but my little brother was the only one there, which shows that his range as an actor is incredible. But I was like, I want to pretend to be asleep. Like, I can't deal with this shit right now. Like, so then I pretend to be asleep, and then I hear him pick up the phone, and he says to the woman at the front desk, "Bring me a fucking pizza." I was like, whoa, you are hardcore, Billy Elliot. So I passed out. I woke up the next morning, and I go to use the bathroom, and the bathroom is destroyed. Like, it looked like if Kurt Cobain actually killed himself and wasn't murdered by Courtney Love, it was so fucked up. Like, the shower curtain was ripped off the rod. There were towels everywhere. But the craziest part was next to the sink, there was a broken coffee pot. And then the sink was filled with fully cooked pasta. It's like, wow, this is crazy. So then I go about my day, and then I get a call from my little brother, and he was like, "Hey, sorry about last night. Shit got weird." I was like, "Yeah, you think so? Just a little bit." And I was like, "I could have sworn I heard two Mexicans." And he was like, "There are fucking Mexicans in here, dude?" I was like, "No, never mind." I was like, why were there towels everywhere? He's like, "Shit got wet." I was like, I could have figured out that one. But I was like, dude, did you not only use the coffee pot to cook pasta, but then you used the sink as a strainer and then a bowl to eat the pasta from? And then there's this pause, and he's just like, "Yeah. Fucking bitch wouldn't bring me a pizza," and hung up the phone. I just wish, like, you could, like, even like 4 years ago, I felt like I could just walk up to a woman at a bar and introduce myself and say, like, "Oh, hey, I like the way your face is shaped, and I'd like to take you to Cinemagic sometime." And she'd be like, "Here's my number, sweet prince. Let's do it." 2 for $20 at Applebee's later, I'm getting a hand job, and didn't even have to buy a large popcorn for that. So it's tough now. It's like all just Snapchats and Instagrams. Just can't deal with it. Figure I'm a comedian, though. I can make a woman laugh, right? Make a woman laugh, right? Woman likes this man with a sense of humor. Not true, though. Musicians. Like, musicians can get any woman they want. Like, Dave Matthews can sing, "Hike up your skirt a little more and show your world to me." And women think that that is sexy. Like, I can't say that shit. Like, every time I've tried, I get escorted off the playground immediately. Although every now and then, as like a single guy, you do get a one-night stand, which I think is an offensive term, and it's absolutely disgusting because it's outdated. I prefer to call them pilot episodes. Show's great, supporting cast sucks, never getting picked up for a full season. But I did find myself in the company of a young lady recently. Totally consensual. I'll tell you guys this one tale, then I'll get out of here. We're making out. That's kissing with tongues. Just want to update. So we're like kissing, we're like making out. Talking dirty. But that's the problem, right? When you're having a pilot episode, like, talking dirty is something for relationships. You get to that point, you can talk dirty, it's fun, like, say things, but I just wanted to experience that. But it's tough talking dirty when you're in a pilot episode, but I was like, you know what, fuck it. So I just like whispered in her ear, I was like, "Take off your pants." Right? And I was like, oh shit, she's not gonna do it because I sound like Christian Bale from Batman. And at that point I was like, fuck it. I was like, "Take off your pants. Swear to me, Commissioner. Where is he? Where is he?" I didn't think it was going to happen, but it did. She took off her pants. She took off her blouse, which is a term from the 80s I'm trying to bring back for myself. Didn't think it was going to happen, but it did. Then she grabbed me by the back of my neck and she whispered in my ear, "Now is not the time for fear." "Oh no, that comes later." Guys, I'm Nick LaValle. Thank you so much. Thanks to Ryan Chaney.
See you next time. Hopefully you guys enjoyed yourselves. Give it up for everyone that's on the show tonight. First show with Double Midnight Comics presents Comics. So hopefully that goes well. Enjoy yourselves. Thank you.